So over the last few years, hundreds of men have been coming out to Atlanta, Georgia to talk about business, style, health and fitness in the effort to become the best men they can be. Guys, I'm talking about StyleCon, and in today's video, I'm going to give you an inside look at this annual conference. Now, gents, we took 20 hours of content, condensed it down to 2 hours. Still, this is the longest video I've ever uploaded to YouTube. I did this because I wanted to give you an inside but detailed view of what goes on at my annual conference in Atlanta, Georgia. If you're not familiar, I run this conference with Aaron Marino over at Alpha M. And I can tell you guys that this is a life-changing conference. And it is so much more than style. I'm talking about health and fitness. We talk about business, communication. It's about men becoming the best that they can be. Now, you guys are probably wondering, okay, there's a lot of presentations I'm gonna have in this video. I wanted to share with you guys what I consider to be some of the best ones. Now, definitely go check out Ryan over at Order a Man. This guy can present a very emotional presentation. And I can tell you, we just put a taste of it on here, but you can get an idea of the way this guy commands a room. Next, go check out AJ over at The Art of Charm, a very interesting subject that he covered, and I think it was just a great presentation. You wanna go check out Andy over at Primer Magazine. Now, Andy didn't even talk about style, but if you're into technical, you're into artistic stuff, you're definitely gonna enjoy his presentation. And Brock over at The Modest Man. I'm gonna end it with, you know. Now, guys, this is just a taste of what's in this video. And I do want you to go explore. There's so much in here. Check out the description. I'll list out everything, try to make it easy to move around. Understand, this is just a taste of StyleCon. The real event, you can watch and you can listen, you can take notes, and guess what? That person comes off the stage and is there and is available for you to ask for clarification, for you to engage them with more meaningful conversation. That's what it's about. One thing I'm proud about this event is the people that go to it come back. And I would love to have you this year. I'm gonna link over where you can grab a ticket right here. We're gonna link throughout the video to be able to grab a ticket. I'm gonna put the description down there. Gentlemen, I want to end this just by saying I really want you to come out to StyleCon. This is a life-changing event. When you get to meet people who you've been watching their channels, you've been learning from their blogs, and you get to meet them in person and realize just how human they are, you realize that you too can push yourself in your particular field, in your particular area, and that you too can achieve greatness. That is my goal with this event, is for the people that attend to leave it and to go off and do amazing things. And we've got some great success stories, which I'm gonna be excited to share at this year's StyleCon. And guys, I hope to see you there. Let me know if you've got any questions. I'll be checking out in the comments, or you can always reach me at Real Men Real Style. This is something that Aaron and I are both proud of, because the goal here isn't, I mean, it's about building relationships. It's about allowing you guys to find that there's a community of men who support the movement of, you know, having self-respect, of having the dignity to dress and to represent whatever it is that drives you. And that's what I love, is that everyone here, you know, I dress for my family, for my business, and for my kids. But that's not the same for everyone. I know some of you guys out there, maybe you're not married, maybe you don't have a business, but you've got your own reason for dressing sharp. But for you to find, in a world where, you know, some people think that if you wear, you know, fragrance, there's something wrong with you, but to be able to come in here and talk with people that understand that, speak the language, that are very open-minded to what you have to say, that's why we created this community.
So when I first met Antonio, little walk down memory lane real quick. I emailed him. I was like, who's this guy writing all these style articles on the art of manliness? And at the time I had a website, it was a membership website, and I needed content. And so I reached out to Antonio. I said, Antonio, hey, I'm Aaron. I've got a men's lifestyle website. Can I use your content? He said, no. I'm like, what a jerk, right? And so from that moment, I didn't like Antonio. I'm like, who is this guy? And then all of a sudden he starts posting videos on YouTube. I'm like, now I really don't like this guy. And so long story short, we developed a little bit of a relationship through Antonio actually reaching out to me and saying, hey, we should work together. We should try and do something. We were both going out to this event in California called VidCon. We should try and do a get together. And so from this point, Antonio and I started to talk quite frequently. And I said to some people, I said, there is no way this guy is actually as nice as he seems. He has to be lying. And unfortunately, or fortunately, I met him and he actually is that nice. And so if it wasn't for Antonio actually reaching out and trying to build a relationship and a friendship and a community, this wouldn't be possible. So it's because you're not a jerk that this is happening. So thank you, sir. Well done.
You know, I have to throw it right back at Aaron because this is the hardest working man. Does this work?
It works.
Okay. This is the hardest working man that I know. This guy up at 5 o'clock in the morning, and I go into my, I show up to work around 8 o'clock, and I've already got 5 emails from him like, Antonio, we need to do this, we need to do this, and we need to do this. I'm like, okay, you know, but he came up, he's like, why don't we have it here in Atlanta? And I'll make sure we got this, this, and this all set up. So I had the idea for it, but Aaron just came in and was the force pushing it. And every single week, I mean, he just helped me implement this. I didn't even have to be here. I just simply would send out emails, talk, you know, create banners for it and do some of the back end work. But Aaron, you're the force that made this happen.
There you go. And so, the other force is my dad, Peter Marino. Say hello. Thank you. He's actually the one that makes this happen. And Ryan Masters. Also, thank you. What's next?
I was trying to think, okay, what's something of value that I can provide to kind of a wide range of audience here? We have, you know, content creators, brand owners, and the commonality between both of you guys is that you have, you know, an audience, whether it's an audience of fans or an audience of customers or both, you have an audience. So this, what I'm going to share with you is something that you can use. As long as you have good content or good products that people want to hear. And real quick, so I've managed pay-per-click and AdWords, YouTube, Facebook ads. I've been doing that for about 8 years. I work now with big clients like, I don't know, Perry Marshall, who's a big AdWords guy. And it's fun and it's, you know, it gets me in the numbers. It's really nerdy, so I really kind of like it. But what I'm going to teach you today is how to manufacture celebrity status and dominate online for mere pennies a day, okay? And this is something that it started off when I tested it when I took a little trip to Austin. I have a fitness channel, but which some of you may know me from, but I also have a country dance channel because I like to country dance. And so when I went to Austin to visit some friends, I was like, hey, I'm going to go to Rebel's Saloon, which is a country dance bar. Didn't know anybody. I was like, let me just go in there, see if there's some hot chicks, you know, and dance and have fun. So I go in there, I start dancing, and everybody's like staring at me. And I was like, oh, is my fly down? Am I wearing the wrong boots? Like, what's going on? Well, later they come up and like, yo, man, we've seen you on YouTube. We love your stuff. Can we buy you a drink? Da 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 da. Like, everyone in the bar. And I was like, holy cow, like, this is awesome. Like, it worked. And when I mean it worked, what happened was is, it's kind of dark, but this is my YouTube channel. This is where I was, and this is one of the instructors there. And before I flew out to Austin, what I did is I deployed this strategy that I'm going to share with you, which basically everyone in that country bar, in this particular case, my audience, like they saw all the ads and they saw me on Facebook, they saw me on YouTube, they saw me everywhere. And so when I showed up there, it's like you have instant credibility if your customers are seeing you everywhere all over the internet. And so it was a really crazy experience. And now, like any country bars that I go to, like pretty much the same thing happens. And it's very interesting. So you can do the same thing. Again, don't think, oh, well, I'm not going to country bar, so it doesn't work for me. No, the point is, if you show up in front of your customers everywhere on the internet, most people don't know how this stuff works, so they just think like you're the most relevant, you're the best, you're the top. Like you get that positive trust and authority transferred over to you just by being smart and spending a couple pennies. So this is a Facebook ad for my channel. So the channel's called Show Her Off, and this is the Facebook ad for that channel. I've got, you know, 700 plus likes, 135 comments, and it gets shared all the time. Girls usually will tag like their boyfriends, like, hey, you know, watch this, I want to learn how to dance. Well, anyone who watches a video of mine or visits a website, this ad is going to show up in their newsfeed. Okay, because if they're watching a video or they visited my website, that's them expressing interest to me, saying, hey, I'm somewhat interested in your stuff. So it's like, cool, well, let me show you more of my stuff. And here, if we hop over to YouTube, this is a country dancing video. This isn't my video. But over here on the right-hand side, this is my ad. And same thing, somebody watching a country dance video is obviously going to be interested in country swing dance tips. Now, you can switch it out here for, you know, whatever your industry is. You know, a lot of style stuff. So if this is a video, you know, this could be one of Aaron's videos, and you can have a little ad running right next to Aaron's videos that's attracting his traffic. Again, only showing to people who are interested in your stuff. And it's like, okay, well, what is it, you know, what does it cost to run these two ads? Well, on Facebook, I'm paying 2 cents per engagement for everyone in Denver, and then across the USA, I'm paying 0.004 cents, so half of a cent, to get somebody, to get in front of somebody who's already expressed interest to me. So this is why you don't need to have, like, it helps if you have thousands of dollars. You know, when I manage bigger accounts, like, we can do a lot more, but you don't need thousands of dollars to take over and dom. Again, this is all about positioning you as a celebrity in the world, because they're like, man, or I've seen you everywhere. Like, you're all over the place. And it doesn't cost much. So if we hop over to YouTube, you know, cost per view, 1 cent, 2 cent, 3 cent, 1 cent. So one cent, it cost me 1 penny to have an ad that somebody watches about, you know, my dance channel. Or, you know, same, I use the same stuff for my fitness channel, for clients. So don't get too hung up on the industry. The process is the same.
The first thing we can do to improve our design, both of these things come from the advertising world. And the first thing we can do is create design archives for ourselves. And a design archive is nothing fancy. It's simply a collection of things that you come across in your daily life that you like. Maybe it's a photography style, maybe it's a typography style, maybe it's just the way they use colors. These are some of the things from my own design archive, and they come from all over the place. You can see in the top right or the top left, that's literally a photo I took from a Gap store because I liked the way they used lines, I liked the fonts they used, and I liked the colors. This is obviously a cover of a book. On the bottom are some things I took out of a magazine. So once you start looking for it, you will find incredible design everywhere. And if you start cataloging it, I use Evernote. I'm sure most of you know Evernote. If you don't, it's a robust note-taking tool. Using it right now. The reason I like it because you can tag your notes. So if I find some text I like, I'll tag it typography. And the reason a design archive is so important is because it gives you a starting place. Especially if you don't consider yourself a designer, opening a blank document and feeling like you have to create an amazing graphic that'll sell your product is incredibly daunting, right? Especially if you're not a designer. So a design archive gives us a place to start. You can say, I like the way they use this color, I like the way they use this font. And 20 steps in, you may go back and you won't even have used anything from it, but it gives you some inspiration to start. The second thing is a style guide. And if you were to hire an advertising or branding agency, what they would provide you with is a style guide. A style guide, very simply, is a document that defines the graphic branding for your company. It includes what fonts to use, how to use them, shapes and colors, and the rules for when you can and cannot use them. And creating a style guide for your own company or website is really important, and it doesn't have to be a 20-page business document. It can be very simple. Here are some things from the primer style guide. I love the font Futura Heavy with a lot of space between the letters. I love using diagonal lines as separators for text. I love using vintage cursive fonts for less important words like and, of, the, or with. I love using vintage arrows. I love using circles that look like badges. And all of these things, again, give me a starting point. I'm not recreating the wheel every time I need to create a graphic for my website. And at this point, I've created graphics for over 1,800 articles. So I've gotten very good at doing decent style, decent graphics very quickly.
Regarding photography, it's, again, so daunting. You want to start a style Instagram, say, and you have this cool outfit, and you take a picture of it, and you're so proud of it, and then you upload it, and you see your feed right away, and it's a bunch of other guys that clearly are working with professional photographers, and you look back at your own photo, and your pants look all baggy, and your shirt's all wrinkled, and it's like, why am I even trying, right? There are very simple techniques that you can do in Photoshop to drastically improve your photography, and those are the things I'm going to go over today. But to start with, there's an important thing you have to realize. You can take a crappy-looking photo and make it look pretty good in Photoshop, but if you have a pretty good photo, you can make it look amazing. So not only what you're wearing or what you plan on doing with it afterward, it's essential that you consider when and how you're going to photograph it. And these two are examples that I took for primer. On the left is obviously an old-fashioned for a cocktail article, and on the right is a photo I did for a style article. In both of them, you can see that there's very consistent lighting, but it's not harsh at all. And there's two ways you achieve that. On the left, especially with food photography, the way these Instagram accounts and these cookbooks get these amazing photos, very simply, you shoot next to a window. This was shot in my dining room at about 4 o'clock, and so you're using indirect sunlight to fill in the photo. You can see the colors are very vivid, you can really see the details on the glass, the ice cube, you can see the little cracks in it. You get this full lighting that you don't get otherwise. And it's very hard to recreate with a flash. If you wanted to do this in a studio, you would need lights all over the place, bouncers, you would need a crew, or you can just do it like I did and do it in your dining room at 4 o'clock and enjoy an old-fashioned afterwards. On the right is a similar concept. You can see in the background on the window, it's very harsh lighting. This was about 3 in the afternoon in downtown LA. But the lighting on him is very soft and consistent. You can see his face and features, but none of it is harsh. And the way we did that was he's sitting at a cafe under an umbrella. So shooting in the shade is essential if you're shooting style photography. Shooting in direct sunlight can be done if you know what you're doing, but even then, it's very difficult. There's a concept in photography and film called magic hour. Magic hour changes throughout the year, but it's essentially, I think it's about 5 o'clock. And it's when the sun starts going down, so the light isn't as harsh, but you still get as much light as you need to fill in the photo. So if you wanted to have good photos out of Photoshop, you gotta think about what they look like going in.
There are brands out there, and there are some that I've spoken to today, that are looking for brand awareness. They're looking to get exposure for their brand, product, and service. And honestly, there really is no better way to do it. I've talked to a lot of brands when I ask what their marketing efforts are. They're basically digital marketing, social media marketing. Ryan Masters had spoken earlier about Google AdWords and remarketing and retargeting and things like that, having a great website and a great platform. All of those things are fantastic. There's one element that's missing, and I think that most of you would agree with me, and probably for the reasons that you're here, is there's a personal connection. There's a personal connection between the person that's watching, and it could be other content creators and influencers. There's a personal connection, even if you've never met Aaron or never met Antonio, or you read something in Primer Magazine, there's a personal connection. You know who, I mean, let me back up for a second. I'm sure that there are a lot of people out here. Does everybody have different magazines maybe that they've read, everyone's read GQ, Esquire, Maxim, maybe Playboy, whatever the case may be. Now, the only person I know from Playboy, Hugh Hefner, he's a player, right? So everyone knows his name. But is there anybody in here that reads Esquire and knows who wrote that article that they're reading? Is there anyone in here that reads Esquire or GQ that knows the editor-in-chief? I don't, and I've been reading those magazines for years. But when you watch Aaron, you make a connection. When you watch Antonio, you make a connection. They're speaking to the masses, they're speaking to you guys. And they, let me tell you, I've known Aaron for 27 years. He's my best friend. Antonio, I've known now since September or August. And I gotta tell you that, there is so much passion behind what they do. And I know that firsthand, and I know that that passion lies with everybody else that we happen to be lucky to work with. So when I talk to these brands that are reaching out, my goals are twofold, right? My goals are to build relationships and partnerships with brands. I'm not just there to take their money or to get them to sponsor with one of our guys. The goal here is to start long-term partnerships, and I'll touch on that in a second. But the idea here is that when a brand, you know, a brand is looking to build their audience, okay? And so they reach out. Maybe they don't know that they have to invest in this type of marketing. They might look at Aaron's video and think, oh, he just propped up a camera, stood there, and just came up with whatever, right? That's not what happens. You know, there's a lot of detail that goes into it, and anybody in here that creates content or produces videos understands that you need a creative concept, you need a direction, you need an angle to go at. If you are sponsoring a product, if you're talking about a product and integrating that into your post, you need to think of a creative way. You want to engage with your audience, obviously, right? You want them to enjoy what they're reading and come away from it with an education. You want to come away from that with information that you can use in your daily life so that you can look better, feel better, and be more confident. And that's, I think, what most of us are here for. That's what most of us want in life, because when you are more confident, you're more successful typically. And so the reason that I enjoy what I do is when a brand reaches out to me, I want to connect on a personal level with that brand because I have been in their shoes. For almost 17 years, I used to manage multi six-figure monthly budgets for marketing. And you think that I wasn't scared about where I'm spending my money, that I didn't make mistakes? Of course. Anybody in marketing, you know, spends money and things, they bomb, they don't work. They find something that works and they continue to go in that direction. And back to what I was saying as far as these long-term partnerships is, just the other day I was on the phone with a company that basically loved the idea when I mentioned we have probably 8 out of 10, 80% of our companies that we work with are returning to us. Not necessarily month after month, but on a regular basis. And what I mean by that is bi-monthly, maybe quarterly, maybe a couple times a year. And to me, that's success, especially when you're talking about marketing and you never know what you're gonna get, right? And so we count, when I was working with Aaron since July, we've had over 26 or 27 companies that have done just promotions with Aaron more than 2 times already. So I don't need to dive in. I have companies ask me, you know, what's the, you know, how much traffic is he going to send to my site? What's the conversion rate gonna be? How much am I gonna sell? If I'm gonna spend this amount of money, am I gonna make that back? If I spend this amount of money, am I gonna make 5 times my return on investment? If I spend this amount of money, am I gonna drive this much traffic? And you know, what I look at is this. If I set your expectations too high, then you're going to expect that. I'm realistic. I don't lie to anybody that I talk to. I'm looking for these long-term partnerships. And what I have to tell you is this. What's great about what the guys that I work with do and what I'm sure a lot of the guys that are out here in the audience do is they love what they do. And that's the first thing that needs to be accomplished is that you love what you do and you have the time to be creative and write your content.
Passion. So you always hear this, you have to have a passion for what you do. Now, I mean, I agree with this to the most extent. If somebody asks me, are you passionate about making undershirts? I mean, to an extent, I'm passionate about making a wonderful product that people enjoy. Now that just so happens to be undershirts, the best undershirts in the world. But you should have a passion for what you're going to do, whether it's a business, a product, or a service. Have a passion. And if you don't have that passion for it, at least have it be something that, for example, if it's a problem that you experienced, it bugs you enough that you want to fix it. And that can also be contrived as or considered a passion as well. One example of that is I always had trouble holding my mobile phone and trying to use it. And I looked for years to try to find something that I, you know, to make it easier to hold my mobile phone. I couldn't find it back 5 or 6, 7 years ago, and I created a product to solve it. And you know, to my recommendation to you is kind of focus on things that either bug you a lot or you're super passionate about. Now, procurement is really about sourcing the product or sourcing the components that you need to create your product. And I can tell you from many, many years talking to people who are starting businesses, one of the big issues that they have is, where do I start? Like, how, where do I find my supply chain? If it's a service, where do I find the people that can help me bring my product or service to market? So procurement is a really big part of a business, and sometimes it can be scary for people to start a business because they don't know where to start. So my biggest tip for you guys, if you're in this stage of wanting to start a business, but you might be afraid to start it because you don't know where to start, my biggest tip is to follow the supply chain. So in my case, undershirts, back in 2007 when I came up with this idea, I had no idea about apparel manufacturing, no knowledge of it whatsoever. I didn't know anybody in the business, and I didn't really know where to start. So I started thinking about it, and I said, well, what makes up creating a shirt or creating a pair of pants? And I said, the very first step is you got to get fabric somewhere. So I started looking for fabric manufacturers, and once I started looking for those people, started talking to them, I was like, okay, now that you have fabric, people are ordering your fabric, where do you send the fabric? And they said, well, we send the fabric to cutters. And so I said, okay, well, that's the next stage in the process. So again, I would say, look at your supply chain and go either forward or backward from, you know, from the beginning or the end of the supply chain and start investigating those piece parts. Another great idea that I've actually done personally myself is find similar products. For example, on Kickstarter, most people maybe have a Kickstarter account. Go to those campaigns, email the campaign creator, ask them where they got their stuff. 9 times out of 10, you'll find people are actually pretty ready, willing, and able to help you out.
Evolve. What do I mean by that? My style. When I was 12, 13, I started to get interested in style, and I wrote an entire article about that, showing me when I was 14. I looked terrible, right? I was interested in style, but I wore bold patterns, orange striped shirts that were very loud, with tan suits, and looking back, it was really bad. But it was a style evolution for me. I started at that point, and I was interested, and still today, I always change my style. Right now, I like the collar pin, right? I have that, I saw it, I like the look, so I wear it a lot. Maybe in 2 years from now, it will be a different style thing that I really like and I will do more of. And it's a constant evolution. You learn more, you get inspired, and you do different things. For the business, it's very, very similar. When I started, I just did it as a hobby. And then 3 months in, people came and said, hey, can I advertise? And I was like, wow, that's great. Somebody wants to pay me money, and I just do what I want to do? That's awesome. Let's do it. Well, and then I noticed, you know, down the line, let's make this big. Let's try to get that many advertisers. And I figured, oh, it would take me 5 years to make $100,000 every month easily, right? Well, I embarked on that journey, and I realized, you know, people don't always pay. People say one thing and do another. It's a huge pain. You spend a lot of time, people say this will happen, and it doesn't. And so we transitioned and offered physical products. Now, this is going well, and it's working out, but we also noticed people like our content a lot, so we're creating content products.
Or when I met Antonio, he was working at a tailored suit. He was working 90, 100 hour weeks. It was very hard on him. He didn't have the right systems in place. He was barely making money and he was just getting by. Now, instead of just folding and saying, that's it, I can't do it anymore, he just said, okay, I already have this. How can I change and do something else? And he saw Real Men in Real Style was giving him value back, so he invested money in that, and that's working out beautifully now. So if you hit a barrier where you think, man, this is not going well, don't just give up. Try to see different ways on how you can make things work. 7, you cannot save your way to prosperity. It's something that sounds very simple, but I grew up in a household where my dad, he's from Brazil, and they had a lot of inflation. So whenever they got money, they went to the store and bought what they could because tomorrow it would only be worth half of that. And my dad and my mom, they were employed. They were nurses. They were used to having a certain amount of money, and that was it every month. So the more deals they found, the more they would get for their money. And so growing up, that was everything I knew. And it works, right? If you get a 90% deal, you feel good, and it's great. But it took me a while, and a mentor who showed me and said, you cannot save your way to prosperity. Even if you get things 99% on sale, it's not gonna make you rich, and you're not gonna get to the point that you wanna get to. And the important aspect about it is, it's time, right? You can make more money, you cannot create more time. Time is finite, and so if you have the chance to get a deal, ask yourself, would it be wiser to invest my time to create more money and get exactly the thing I want, or do I just buy this because it's on sale and I wear it maybe once and that's it? And I think that's a really good mindset to have, and it helps you to analyze yourself and your behavior and invest in something new that creates more wealth for you rather than just saving on other things. Because you may look at that Porsche, right, and you think, oh, it's so expensive, I can never afford that. And you settle for the Honda Civic instead because it's affordable and green. Well, yes, it may be a super deal, you may be getting a super bargain, but at the end of the day, if you would build a business and spend more, you could afford that Porsche and be happy and have it all together.
But what is the hardest thing that you've had to overcome in terms of your YouTube journey? Jose?
Well, I think it's what you were saying right now, the fact that you're trying to please everyone. You know, it's still hard to this day. I mean, I'm a lot more comfortable because I know my audience and I've been speaking to them for a while, but it's still hard to speak into a camera and know that you're going to reach 1,000 men or 100,000 men behind that camera and that you're going to try to please every single one. And just like Aaron said, a lot of the times you're going to get really harsh comments, and some are very bad. It's not, you know, constructive criticism. I wish it was that. But instead, it's mostly insulting your personhood. And that's, like he said, it hurts. So that's something you have to overcome. And it's come to a point where you just have to ignore it. But me, I have pretty bad temper, so it usually gets to you, you know, but.
And that is, and I would just say, from experience, the absolute worst thing you can do, try and reason with somebody on YouTube that is make it, it's like, nah, they just got to know me. It'd be okay. Don't engage them. Don't give them that was bad.
I've gotten pretty good at engaging with the haters and kind of calling them out. So I disagree. Like if someone throws something that doesn't stick, normally what I'll do is I'll repeat exactly what they're saying, but I'll enter in like internet troll or something like that. And then my fans in our community usually is pretty supportive. So they'll gang up on the haters as well. And
so what was the most difficult thing for you with YouTube?
Well, I think the challenge for me is kind of what like Tanner said, is seeing videos that you put out and other people out there who just do these fantastic videos. And I know that I want to create videos of that level, but I also want to build my business and develop new products. And all the time that we have in the day, like creating a video takes an obscene, like a good video, it takes an obscene amount of work and editing and organization and planning. And I haven't yet committed to that. So I still have like average to good videos.
So for me, the hardest thing is that you're really putting, like Eric said, you're really putting your heart and soul into this, and you think you've got this amazing message to share with people, and then all of a sudden you have crickets. Like, nobody responds, nobody views your video, and you're like, what, man, if only people heard this, this could change their lives. And so it's really frustrating to see all your heart and soul and passion to go into something, and you kind of have to fall back on the fact and, remember, hey, why am I doing this? Why is it that this is valuable to me, regardless of who shows up? So that's been the biggest challenge for me, is to see that sometimes I have success, and other times when I think I will, I don't have the traffic or the visibility or the comments, and people don't respond the way I would hope that they would. That's been tough.
I think one of my toughest parts of creating video content is just sticking with the consistency. Obviously, that's important and relates to all parts of your business, but just creating a content schedule so that you're planning ahead week after week or month after month and know what you're going to be putting out and sticking with it so that your audience can expect your delivering of video content on time.
For me, it's the haters. Like, you put all your effort into, literally, you pour your heart and soul into a video, you edit it for 2-3 hours, you know it's good information, you know it's gonna help people, you put it up, and then you get these retards just writing whatever they wanna write. And I try my best not to let them get to me, but like Aaron said, it hurts every single time. And they attack not only you as a person, but like, you know, all your insecurities are just blasted on YouTube. And it's just like, okay, you're a dick. So, I mean, I don't really have a good way of dealing with it. I've engaged them. I've not engaged them. I've engaged them way to the point where I shouldn't have. And I'm probably still going to do the same thing tomorrow. So, that's all I got.
So, I'm different from the rest of these guys. And it's probably because I'm new enough to real YouTube hate that for me, it's just like, yes, like I made it. Like, I have these idiots who hate me. And that's finally like this badge of, you know, I'm not just this tiny little channel anymore. And so, try it. For me, I like to see it as an opportunity where it's just like, you know, negative attention is better than no attention, and there's those variables that come with it. But for me, the most difficult thing is, and I see this a lot even with guys who want to dress better or you want to improve any sort of content, you have a taste level that may be here, and you have an ability to execute that's down here. And it takes getting down into the trenches and really muscling through and getting all those things to get to where you're producing or dressing as well, you're doing what you want to be doing. And there's no shortcuts through that. You can have people who mentor you through it, but it really just comes down to the grind of it and committing to the fact that it's gonna suck for a while, and you have to get through the suck to get to what you want it to be. So.
Shave soap, pre-shave, and a brush. And I'm just gonna give you a quick demo on how to use this, so when you go home tonight or when you go back to the hotel or when you get home from your trip, you can understand like the proper way to actually shave. And get away from the you know, even if you keep your cartridge, I'm fine with that. I would really highly recommend that you go into a safety razor, which is more of the old school twist to open or three-piece razor. So the first thing you do is you're gonna take your brush out, open up your soap. These synthetic brushes aren't like Badgers where you have to soak them in hot water for a while. They're ready to go, really. You can just run a little hot water on it. And all you have to do is just muddle the brush about 30 times into your soap. Now, you can build your lather a couple different ways. I use a hand, but the easiest way when you're beginning is a scuttle. And all you need to do is put about a quarter to a silver dollar size amount of water in the bottom of this of a scuttle or a mug, and you just work it around. And you're gonna work it for about, you're gonna notice your bubbles. When you stop seeing bubbles and the bubbles get smaller and smaller and it becomes more of a lather, now you have a quality lather to lather your face. This is a much better way of maintaining your face, even if you have, you know, if you grow a beard. I got friends that grow beards, but you should still clean with a brush. It's so much better for you than using a gel that is chemical based. These are all, you know, these soaps are all natural, so they're heavy in vitamin E, avocado oil, apricot oil, really quality products, good for your skin. It's gonna exfoliate, it's gonna remove dirt, and it'll prep your skin properly for when you shave. The biggest trick is making the lather that's right for you. I hand lather, So I don't use a scuttle. I'm always in a hurry. I'll muddle it 20 or 30 times, and I just run a little bit of water in my hand, and I'll sit here and hand lather like this. And I know when I have the good consistency, I can put a little more water in there. You don't want it to run off your hand. You know, it's gonna be thick. It's gonna be more like your gel, and it takes a little while to get there. At first, you're gonna think, oh, I'm not doing it right. Just work it a little bit longer, and then you can just work it in your face, and then you can use your hand as well. And this is a great way to shave, just with a cartridge or even a disposable razor. And I would encourage you all to enjoy the quality of wet shaving. Learn the art. And as you go on, I would really encourage you to buy a safety razor, buy a straight razor, and try those as well. I'm not going to push straight razors on you guys, but reality is a safety razor is a great way to shave. And a brush and a soap is a great way to groom and clean yourself, clean your face. I use it all over my head. Please feel free at the end of the day or anytime during the day. We have sets back there that you can pick and pack, white brushes, black brushes, quality soap, and a pre-shave oil. And I'm happy for you guys to take those home and enjoy the art of shaving.
But I read an article called 1,000 True Fans. And what that means is if you can convince 1,000 people to pay you $100 every year, you make a comfortable six-figure living. I obviously want more than that, so I call it 1,000 True Fans Plus. But if you, the article's there, and it basically says that all you have to do is convince one person a day to like you, and that makes it very feasible for a lot of people to kind of break it down. Okay, it's not very hard to gain a following of, 1,000 people versus Aaron's, which is over 1,000,000. That's very, it's a huge chunk. So you're like, holy crap, I can't do that. But if you really break it down, anybody can do that. So this is how you get your fans. Now, if you're looking at this from a marketing perspective, that's kind of where I'm going towards. But this applies to networking, moving up the corporate ladder, any type of, meeting women, attracting women. It's all the same principles. You have to build one common enemy. And there's a lot, and what that means is you have to build a group and a cult around something that everybody either really hates or really likes. There's no middle ground. You can't be a guy to please everybody. You got to really piss people off, and then the other half is going to really like you. So here's, my brand is called Handsome Guy Secrets, and that is our common enemy. So, and obviously, I'm not a big suit guy, but you get the point that I'm leading them and that I'm Ryan Gosling. So my audience is 18 to 34 year old males, and this is like our mission. We hate average and mediocre people who never get laid or have terrible relationships, hate their jobs, and are always broke. So that is the enemy that I have created, and everybody in my Facebook group, email list, gets reminded of that enemy pretty much every single day. So here's some other people with clear and defined common enemies. Donald. So anybody, either you like him or you hate him, but you know who he is. So his enemy is anyone who is an American. It's very clear cut. Conor McGregor, he's a really successful UFC fighter. He's a poor Irish guy who made it. His enemy is like anybody that's rich and wealthy, and he has new money and he flashes it, and he's got a really awesome following of people that love him for that, because he basically stands for an entire country. And that is awesome, and I love that guy. He's insanely polarizing, if you will. Kanye West, common enemy, music industry, fashion industry. I pretty much think the guy hates everyone, but he is a brilliant marketer, and everything, I don't know him, I wish I did, because I think everything that guy does is highly calculated. I don't think he does anything at random. There's a reason why the day before his shoes launched that he just had a meltdown on Twitter, because I tried to buy the shoes, it was impossible. So this is essentially what you want to do, is piss on anyone who's against your common enemy. In your videos, your emails, your blog posts, your group, you have to really set the ground for what you want to portray. And this is, this is a book called Influence by Robert Cialdini. He's got 5 weapons of influence, as he calls it, but that's the principles are there, but it's very outdated. It's an old book. So it does work, but this is kind of like a new school version of that and how to use this online today. So step one, you always have to provide massive value. So you have new people coming to you every day who have no idea who you are. So if you're leading with taking money, it's never gonna work. This is how I always provide value, and I put recommended because I think everybody should be doing all these. Number one is I send an email pretty much every single day. They average 500 to 1,000 words in length. It's a lot to write every day. But people read that, they're like, holy crap, this guy's sending me so much information every single day. I love him. Then it's YouTube videos, as many as you can do per week. There's nothing, like I said yesterday, there's nothing better than looking in somebody's eyes, teaching them something that they don't know. and it builds such a strong bond. A Facebook group, I started my Facebook group like a little over a year ago, and the testimonials and the stories that come out of that group have been like highly instrumental in my marketing and what I use for my business, because when I show somebody a Facebook testimonial, it's real. If I just wrote it in an email, it looks fake. But when you see, people see it on Facebook, it's highly like, wow, this guy's real. He's like, people are in his group talking good about him. We love him. I call it a badass free giveaway. This is how you build your list. Basically, you make a product that you would essentially charge for and give it away for free. And that's hard for a lot of people to do because everybody wants to make money from the get-go. And this model, you're probably not going to make money for 6 months because you just have to keep giving content. And that's how you build this influence. Make a lot of products. Once you build an audience, and you don't need much. I was doing roughly $50,000 a year with about 5,000 people. So you don't need to build a whole lot. You just have to really market to them well. I make a lot of products. I have everything from ranging $9 on up to $1,000. I provide services if they want them. I try not to because I just don't like talking to people like for an hour at a time. I just better spent doing other stuff. And I don't have a blog. I have really no website other than YouTube and product sales pages. So blogs to me just take a really, really long time to get traction going. So I always try to avoid them. Step number two is make them like you. And this comes from you're already providing value to them, so they're already receptive to who this guy is as a person. They're like, wow, I like him. He's making me, you know, he's teaching me stuff. You know, then it's set your standards for what you want to expect your followers. So this is different from everybody else because everybody just kind of wants to cater to the customers. If somebody meets you for the first time and you're instantly saying, yo, you're not a fit, get out. Like, nah, you wear New Balance shoes, I don't like you. Like, things like that, you set this standard, and then the people that do come to you start seeing that you have rules. I have to follow this guy's rules to be in his cult or his influence. And that creates that common enemy even stronger, and you have a bond with your followers that you can't recreate. Tell them why you were better. Now, that sounds very arrogant, but I have found that the more you remind people what you do that's really cool, how many followers you have, how many products you have, the fact that you actually do what you say, you provide value, you treat your customers with respect, they latch to that. But people will quickly forget that. They will not, you know, they will not remember that each time you open an email or write a product. You have to keep reminding them over and over again, just like the common enemy. Who are we against? Who are we against? It's very repetitive. But once you've done it for so long, I have people that send me like the craziest testimonials and things of that nature. And when I do YouTube videos, I talk directly at the camera. They look directly into my eyes. I'm kind of against the lookbooks in the fashion world because I just feel it's very impersonal. I want to show you, like talk to you, tell you why it works, and then show you by my head. So that's like yesterday I was saying I wanted to change that. That's kind of how I'm doing it, just because I believe that people need to hear why they should be wearing something.
Something happened when I told you I crashed and burned at 30. I was the guy, I dove into all the information about exercise, physiology, biomechanics, nutrition. I studied all the disciplines from a lot of the leaders, world experts in these areas. But nobody talked about sleep. And I found myself at 30 years old, sitting down on the couch, feeling my knees ache, and thinking, what the hell is going wrong? I have low energy all the time, my joints ache, but I'm doing everything right. I'm not the guy who never paid attention to his health. I paid all the attention to my health. I did all the things that they said you were supposed to do. I ate my grass-fed organic beef, my wild-caught fish, ate my organic vegetables, went into the gym, I lifted weights, I competed in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, I was a healthy guy, or so I thought. And that's how I found sleep. And it changed. It was the missing thing. So if you're right now trying to lose weight, trying to get in better shape, trying to get better results from the gym, trying to feel more energy, what I tell people now is that there's no exercise you can do, no diet you can follow, no supplement you can take that can make up for good quality sleep. So what do you do? This is my favorite part. Number one is make sleep a priority. Make it a priority. Not this weekend, because you're going to be out networking, having a few drinks, making friends, exactly what you should be doing. But when you're back home, and it's just kind of an off night with not a lot going on, don't be on the phone on Facebook or on Instagram, checking out all the hot girl pictures, or whatever you guys are up to. Okay? Get natural light in the morning. This is a huge deal. In fact, how many of us came from the hotel right into here and we'll stay here all day, we'll leave when it's dark? That's most of our lives. Natural light, sunlight, set something called your circadian rhythm. Your circadian rhythm is your biological clock. It's the reason why, if some of you have come from several time zones away, why you're having trouble right now, right? Having trouble sleeping. So getting light early in the morning helps set those circadian rhythms. Get outside, get some sunlight, 30 minutes. And another thing that sunlight does is it raises your vitamin D levels. Vitamin D actually is not a vitamin, it's a hormone. And it's produced in your skin as a result of direct sunlight, excuse me. So most of us don't get enough light. Most of us are afraid to get enough light, direct sunlight, because of what dermatologists say. Maybe there's something there. But if you're not getting enough vitamin D from direct sun, you definitely need to supplement with it. What you need to do, go get some blood work done. Go to your doctor, find out what your vitamin D levels are. Vitamin D is also associated with low testosterone if vitamin D is low, especially in guys in their 40s. So exercise in the morning. They did a study with three different groups of people. People who worked out in the morning, people who worked out in the afternoon, people who worked out at night. People who worked out in the morning had better quality sleep. And we'll go into exactly what that means, but getting some exercise in the morning is critical. Now, if you're a guy who likes to lift weights in the afternoon because your strength is higher and it's the optimal hormonal environment and all that, cool, but get something going on in the morning. Okay? Caffeine curfew. I love coffee. It's great, but if you have it too late in the day, it's going to affect your sleep quality. Number one, it'll keep you up at night because you'll still be wired. My fellow coffee drinkers have experienced that before. But it also affects the sleep quality, your sleep cycles. We'll get to what that is in a second. So here's something you can do right now. All of you should install this free app onto your laptops, your home computers. This is on the left. That's a normal computer. Normal computers give off a lot of blue light. Blue light affects your circadian rhythms. We already kind of talked about that. What we know about blue light, the light right here, the lights that all of us are exposed to on our devices, on our iPads, and from our televisions, from our fluorescent lamps. I saw someone yawning, just getting tired. It's good. So that suppresses melatonin and affects your sleep quality. Melatonin is a hormone, it's produced in your brain, and it gives you good quality sleep. Doesn't necessarily cause sleep, but this is a huge deal. This is something you can go and put on your devices and install it right away. And it changes the light to this orange tint, which has less an effect on your hormones, all right? On melatonin secretion. Hashtag science. Okay? Install blackout blinds. That's actually too light, but I didn't want to put up just a black slide up. Put blackout blinds in your room. And if you can do this and see your hand, it's still too light. I have blackout blinds in my house, made a huge difference. Still, some light comes in. That's why you can use a SleepMaster mask. In addition, this is the highest quality one that I've tried. I don't sell them, by the way, in case you're wondering. But really, blocking out that light is critical for quality sleep.
And I was delusional about where I was. I said to myself, I can't work out, I can't do these things because I'm busy. I'm providing for my family, I'm being a dad, I'm doing this. I can't take care of this stuff right now. But I became keenly aware of it when my boys came up to me one afternoon and they said, Dad, we want to go outside and play. Can we go play? And I had to look them in the eye and I had to say, sorry, sons, I can't. I'm tired, I'm exhausted. I physically cannot do that. And that's when I became aware. But what happened? Excuses. I started to tell myself, well, I'm busy. I don't have time for this. There's no gym around here. I don't know how to work out. A gym membership's expensive. And I could have been very easily went back. I could have reverted back to the way things were, but I didn't. I decided to execute on new information. The reason I executed on new information is because I used a powerful tool, which is your reason. Now, some of you may have heard of it as your why. My reason for getting in shape was to be able to spend quality time with my kids, to be able to put in the time that they needed from me that I didn't have growing up. And so as things got difficult, I remembered that it was them I was doing it for. Have you guys identified your why? Why do you want to start a business? Why do you want to build wealth? Why do you want to look the way you do? Why do you want to have a meaningful relationship with your wife and kids? If you don't know those things, you're never going to have it. So first step, find out your why. The next step I want to talk about is wealth. I'm a financial advisor by trade. I have been for 9 years. I've seen some amazingly successful people, and I've seen some amazingly unsuccessful people. And the people that have success when it comes to building wealth in their life, they all have one thing in common. I'm going to get to that. But I want to tell you a story of a client of mine without naming any names. This man is extremely successful. He goes around the country and he builds hotels, and he's extremely successful. He's a strong guy. He's physical. He's doing physical work. He's 55 years old. And because he's strong and because he's good at it, he's delusional. He's delusional in the fact that he thinks he's always going to be able to do it. But there's a reality that he's not always going to be able to do it. And not too long ago, one of his friends from high school got in a car accident. And this man became disabled. And he became aware. He understood that maybe I'm not going to be able to do this forever. Maybe I'm not invincible. That's the time he called me. So he calls me up and he says, "Ryan, I need to sit down with you." He comes into my office. And the first thing he does is come up with all the excuses as to why he can't make this work in his life. "I'm too late to the party. I don't know where to begin. I don't have the money to save. My wife's not on board with this." This is what we do. We come up with excuses. And I told him, I said, "Look, you can revert back to the way things were, or you can work with me and we can figure out a game plan to get you to where you want to be." And this is the second tool. The second tool is accountability. Finding somebody in your life who is going to hold you accountable, who's going to help you, who's going to guide you, who's going to direct you, who's going to tell you the things that need to be said. Now that's hard because we don't want to hear the things sometimes we need to hear, but the reality is it's exactly what needs to happen. Do you have somebody in your life who's like that? Or do you have what I call a lot of bobbleheads in your life that say, "Yep, you're really good. Yep, everything you're doing is right." Those people aren't helping you. You need people who are going to help you toe the line, slap you in the face when you need it, because that's what's going to help you get what it is you want to get. Now let's go to my relationships. This is the story that Antonio is referring to. This is my family here. I've got 3 kids, one more on the way in 3 weeks. I'm excited about that. And 5 years into my wife and I, our marriage, like a lot of you guys, things get hard, right? I get busy. I've got work. She's got the kids. We've got stuff, right? Life. That's just what happens. And I was delusional about our relationship. It wasn't great, but it wasn't horrible. It was kind of blah. There's my wife, I'm her husband, this is kind of how life is, and this is how it'll always be. And it came to a head, and I became keenly aware of the problem when one evening we got into an argument. I can't remember what the argument was about. But what I do remember, like it was yesterday, saying to her is, "I don't even want to be married to you anymore." That breaks my heart even saying that. And she said the same thing to me. And she left the next morning. And throughout the course of time, I got really upset. And I blamed a lot of it on her. Why isn't she doing this? Why isn't she doing that? Why is she not being a good wife? Why doesn't she appreciate me? Why doesn't she love me? All of those things that I'm sure a lot of you guys have probably said in your life and in your marriage, unfortunately. And I don't know why it changed, but for some reason it changed in my life. And I begin to think about this differently, that maybe it wasn't her fault. Maybe it was my fault. Maybe I was the one who was being disloyal. Maybe I was the one who wasn't there for her. Maybe I was the one who wasn't being the man when I thought she wasn't being the woman. It was my fault, guys. And I started to ask myself powerful questions. And that's tool number 3, powerful questions. I said to myself, "Why is she this? Why is she that? Why about her?" In all reality, what I needed to do is I needed to turn the mirror and look at myself and say, why aren't you being the man you need to be? What kind of man do you need to become? Who do you need to surround yourself with? What things do you need to learn so you can win your family back? And the reason I showed you that last picture is because as I started to ask those questions and reflect upon who I was and who I wasn't being at the time, I was able to win my wife back. We'll be married for 12 years. this year. Appreciate that. Thank you. I know it doesn't work out like that for everybody, but I promise as you turn the mirror inwards and you start looking at yourself, you're going to change your life.
So there's this guy, Ramit Sethi. He runs a site called I Will Teach You to Be Rich. It's about entrepreneurship. In his emails, he injects a little bit of his personality into them, right? So he tells me about, well, as if he's talking to me, he tells me about like the fact that when he was growing up, he was like a scrawny little kid. He has cheap Indian parents. He doesn't play sports. He doesn't understand sports. He likes terrible pop music. Little things like that always made me feel like, almost like I'm reading a friend's email, right? So I was able to connect with him that way. There's this guy, Derek Halpern, who runs a site called Social Triggers. It's about marketing, entrepreneurship, business, et cetera. He has this sort of persona as like a brash, kind of abrasive New Yorker, like no nonsense, doesn't take any shit, et cetera. And if you can appreciate like this no-nonsense approach to business and marketing, you're gonna love this guy, right? Kind of polarizing, but if you like that delivery, then you're gonna like this guy. So all of that to say, when you're looking for your hook, you want to be unapologetically yourself. It's important to be yourself, and if not, and you blend in, you end up becoming invisible. So always stay true to yourself when you're looking for your hook. Back in 2012, I published this guest post on my site called, it was called Favorite Clothes of a Minimalist. And this really resonated with me because when I was growing up, I had a ton of clothing, like a ridiculous amount of clothing. I think at one point at my parents' house, I had like three closets filled with clothes. And I probably only wore like maybe 10% of that stuff. It's ridiculous. I grew up, I moved to the city, I live with my wife. We have very limited closet space living in the city. So having a ton of clothes that I don't wear isn't even an option, right? And so I learned to curate this wardrobe that was filled with only things that I love to wear and that went well with each other. I ended up calling this process of curation the lean wardrobe, which essentially is, definition's right there, the minimum amount of clothing that a guy needs in order to have maximum versatility in his wardrobe. So my ideal lean wardrobe will be different from yours, and yours will probably be different from his, right? Because based on whatever you do for work, what you do for play, what your budget is, things like that, you're gonna create a lean wardrobe that makes sense for you. Anyway, I started talking about this on my site, and I would get eventually a ton of feedback and emails. People are telling me, oh man, I love this idea. Like, I don't like having a ton of clothes that I don't wear. How do I make a lean wardrobe for myself? How do I apply this to my life? And I was like, oh, that's my thing. That is my hook. That's the way I can approach personal style through this lens of a lean wardrobe and teach guys this method. And so now, everything that we create, whether it be free e-guides or courses, books, etc., we always try to focus on this idea of a lean wardrobe because that is kind of our identity now, and this is how people know us, and this is how we can teach style in our own through our own unique lens. Okay, so how do you find your hook? If you have a product or you have a blog, you want to know how you can find your unique hook. You have to ask yourself, what drives you? What defines you, right? So let's say you want to start a leather goods company. You want to make wallets for men. What makes your approach different from everybody else? There are probably 5 or 6 companies off the top of my head I can think of right now that are making leather wallets, right? What makes you different? Is it your approach? Is it the tools that you use? Is it where you get your leather? Is it you come from like a 4-generation family who's always worked with leather? Whatever your unique thing is, make sure to figure that out and think about that when you're trying to figure out what your hook is. If you're not sure, you should ask somebody close to you, somebody that you love. Maybe it could be your wife, your husband, your dog, your best friend, someone who knows you really well. They might not be able to help you precisely, but they might say something. They might have an observation of you that what kind of kick something off in your head and make you realize like, oh, that's a really cool angle that I have that I never really thought about. And always add personal stories wherever you can. If it's in your about page, your product descriptions, anywhere you have a chance to add a little bit of personality to your story, you should do so. Kind of like the thing with Ramit, you want to be able to like, I feel like he's my best friend because we're besties, right? Like he emails me all the time and he tells me about things about his life and how he was scrawny growing up. But he teaches me about business too, right? He's not really my friend, but I feel that way because he emails me. So always add a personal story. You want your readers to feel like they know you. If they do that, that's great. So essentially you want to know, what is your perspective, right? Like, what is your unique point of view that no one else can compare to? Your future readers and your future customers, they want to know how you view this thing that you do, whether it's a blog or a product. They want to know all about it. They want to know how you see it. So don't worry about, like I said, don't blend in. You want to stand out. You want to make sure that you show people what your unique perspective is. So I found a few examples that I thought were pretty cool that I want to give you sort of like a takeaway from that. There's a, I don't know if any of you guys have seen any of these sites, but let me know. There's a site called Simple Green Smoothies. It's basically two moms who love green smoothies, and they teach the world how to make them. Pretty simple, right? They have a ton of recipes on their website. They have a recipe book. They have a huge following, a large email list. People love them. What's unique about them? I don't know. Just two moms making green smoothies. My buddy Steve runs a site called Nerd Fitness. His whole premise is he teaches nerds how to get fit. That's it. Super successful, crazy site. There's another site called Fluent in 3 months. My buddy Benny runs it. He basically takes you from zero to conversationally fluent in any language within 3 months. Not a year, not 3 years, not some random amount of time, but in 3 months you can learn a language and have a conversation with somebody. Kind of cool, right? Like, unique. But the point of this is, though, is that it doesn't have to be extreme. Like, you don't have to have some revolutionary, crazy point of view, right? It just needs to be like a small twist on something relatively normal, like teaching nerds how to get fit. How come no one has ever taught nerds how to get fit before, right? Small twist. That's all you want.
A beard journey is an awesome journey, and it's something I recommend everyone do at least once in your life. Like, grow a beard out for a year, see what it's like. If you like it, cool, keep it. If you don't like it, shave it off. No sweat off your back. All right, so really, like, how do you actually properly grow a good, full, thick beard? Well, the first step, this is Portland, Oregon. You gotta move there because everyone in Portland's got a beard, and it just happens. Like, I don't know what it is. It must be something in the water. But seriously, it comes down to five basic principles. This is a very handsome guy. This is not me, this is Carlos. He's got the best genetics in the world. Look at this. This hair is like just gloringly like thick. The beard is thick and black and dense. And then he's like handsome. So, genetics. We got patient, good habits, good health, grooming. This is my face when I look at Carlos. I've got pretty good genetics. I grow a pretty good mustache. But you got what you got. All right, you gotta work with what you got. You know, you can't change your genetics. You can swear and cuss at your grandparents or your mom or your dad or whatever for not being able to grow a good beard, but you got what you got. But the good news is you can kind of work with that, right? So not everyone has to have the exact same beard, just like not everyone has the same hairstyle, right? Everyone has different beard styles. So the number two tip is patience, right? You can't deal with genetics. So those are out of control. You can't focus on it. You can't get a thicker beard. If you got patches here, you can't worry about trying to grow things in there. Don't go on the web looking to buy like beard growth pills and stuff like that, because it's almost like penis enhancement stuff. Like, they're just selling you, taking your money, and you can grow a healthier beard that grows quicker, but it's not going to fill in. Unless you get like a beard transplant or like Rogaine or something like that. But patience, like the number one challenge that everyone has is just that patience. Like, a beard is not itchy, okay? What's itchy is the shaving process. And when you shave, you've got a hair sticking out, the razor comes across, it tugs at the hair. And what you're essentially doing each time you shave, you're creating like little spears. And then as they grow out, they're like jabbing you back in your neck, and it's like, ah, ha, 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 you shave, I wanna screw you over. So like, once you can kind of like get by that phase, and as like the ends of the hair is kind of dull and they soften up, like that itch goes away. And then also, like, as you grow your beard out, then it's gonna start filling in. You know, like the length will hide a lot of the sparseness or any kind of patchiness that you have. Because like literally there's 5% of the world who can grow like this big, thick, dense, full beard. that everyone thinks that every other guy has. But if you really look at other guys' beards, you'll notice that we all have flaws in our beards, and we all have beards that we kind of wish were different. So patience is a big rule. When you're growing out your beard, I always recommend, like, let's say you've given it a month of growth. Before you shave it or cut it off, give it a day. So if you've been growing for 6 months, give it 6 days. And then after 6 days, you know for sure the beard's not for you, then cut it off. But you definitely don't want to, like, get drunk and be like, I don't like this, and shave it off, you know? Actually, if you've been drinking, don't even think about trimming or doing anything or your beard. All right, so the other thing when you grow your beard is you're going to get a lot of peanuts in the peanut gallery talking about whatever. And you just got to ignore the haters, man. Haters going to hate. You got your own beard, and just walk around like that. That's what I do. It works great. Now, what are some of the good habits? Like, you want to, as your beard gets longer, you want to stroke your beard rather than pick at your beard. So having a beard, one of the best things is the ability to actually stroke your beard. And on average, a guy is going to stroke his beard 720 times a day. I don't know if you knew that or not. So stroking the beard, because what happens if you pick at it, you can actually start to develop some, like, bald spots. So if you do pick at it, or you can cause, like, split ends. So you want to be gentle on your beard. It's best to not even, like, touch your beard if possible, but that's kind of hard to do. You guys, if you've seen me this weekend, I'm always, you know, just kind of working on it. But I got a photo of Carlos. He's got a picking habit as well. So you're in the majority if you kind of play with your beard. So don't sweat too much over it. It's a beard, like, it's not rocket science. So you don't, like, don't eat yourself up over it. In terms of good health, these activities have been proven to actually enhance your beard and help you maximize your genetic potential. So you can't go above your genetic potential, but what you can do is live up to it. And if you're not eating healthy, if you've got high stress, if you have a crappy diet, and if you're not exercising, then you're not going to have the fullest beard that you can actually grow.
So one of the things that you first start looking at when you create an app like this is, how does a virtual stylist work in comparison to a real stylist? And then I took Aaron as a real stylist here. The first thing is, you're going to discover lots of plus sides by using a stylist on your phone. You're going to discover it's going to take very little time for people to get advice very quickly. The advice is instant. It must be easy to shop. And then there comes a really cool one. It's the real color coordination. Color coordination is an incredibly complex subject. I can probably stand here for 4 hours and only talk about color coordination. I actually wrote a Reddit post, and I thought I'd write a little post about it, and it's 40 pages long. And the thing is, why it's so complicated is we're being trained that colors come in seasons. So you kind of figure out what kind of season your skin color is, and then you get a suggestion of a palette that works for you. But in reality, every color goes with every color. The thing that matters in the colors is, what are the proportions of the color, and how is it relative to the color next to it? So, and then you get to a very mathematical equation that's almost impossible to calculate from the top of your head. So that's why we stick with seasonal palettes. It's something that is translatable. It's something that is very easy to tell. Another thing that a virtual stylist has in favor of a real stylist is, there's a gigantic amount of garments in there. I'm offering in the app 200,000 garments. And all of them should match in a way that works. The last thing is, it instantly learns from you who you are. So while you're using it, the app starts to see what you like, what you don't like. It starts to predict when seasons change and what your taste might be. So it's going to grow and it's going to develop with you. It's really going to be your personal best friend. The downsides that you have is, an app is always going to be bad at fit. It's almost impossible to look at a garment from an algorithm and think, oh, this is going to look great on that kind of person. You really don't know what it's going to look like and how it's going to work. It doesn't understand personality. It can create a suggestion. It can get into the details, but it doesn't really understand true personality or culture, for that matter. It's very difficult to get your own wardrobe in there. It's easy if you buy something from the app because it's immediately added and you can start using it. If you want to add your own, you need to photograph your entire wardrobe. It needs to be analyzed. It takes a lot of time and it's really annoying to do. And it tends to be trend focused. Most of these algorithms, they work in a way where they get more and more precise and they get into this little box and it's very hard for them to get out of that box. So if you have a season where a certain color is popular, then all the trends are going to focus on that color and it's starting to lose personal touch. So then we have the real stylist. And the thing is, the real person, he has probably less plus points and less minus points. But the points are so much more important. You got the personal touch. Someone to talk to, someone to understand you, someone to work with you. A real stylist teaches you. He learns to understand not only fashion, but also part of yourself. There's a laser point on focus. It's so a personal stylist knows exactly what's going to work for you, and he can point it to exactly every detail why. And he understands culture because he lives in it, he's born in it. But there are two main bad sides that I see there. It's a very high investment to get on board with a stylist. You need to first get the courage to talk to one, but you also need the money to be able to support it, especially if it becomes a habit. And that's also the high barrier of entry. It's just hard for someone who's never really dealt with fashion to go to a stylist and say, I want to get dressed by you. So I started working on the algorithm. I worked on it for 2 years, trying to get it right. And and I went to a friend. I finally uploaded the database of garments. And I said to a friend, like, all right, this is going to be our first run. It's going to be perfect. And the result was this. A Spider-Man shirt, a very blue Speedo, white sports socks, Oxfords, and glasses. And this is also, for me, where it really became obvious how much you need the personal touch and how much you need to work with people in it. You can't just focus on the algorithm alone. There are so many cultural things to consider. It's design-wise, this could actually work. This could be a very interesting composition. I made a painting out of the same color balances, and it actually became quite popular in the online spaces. But the problem with it, it's absolutely ridiculous. And it doesn't work in our cultural rules that we have on how we should wear, what we should wear, and what's appropriate. So where we're heading to right now is I'm currently working on a system that lets designers and stylists train the algorithm. So they can sit down with it and they can go, I would wear this, I would do this, I would do this. And slowly the computer would start to learn from them and it would start to become, in this case, like a mini Aaron. And everyone that uses the app can select mini Aaron and get style advice that comes from him, from who he is and the choices he made based on his culture. And this is where I think that these kinds of apps need to go. They need to go to personal advice. They need to go to actual people that that have their own algorithms, that have their own style in there, and that can be broadcasted to thousands of users.
Social capital is the value or utility or influence you have in your network, in those relationships you have. Now, some of us right now might think we don't have much of a network. We don't know too many people. Our network's pretty small. So how do we build that network? How do we build that value? Obviously, events like this are a great place to meet people, exchange business cards, but value is not built on the surface. It's not built through Facebook friends and likes, but it's real, genuine relationships. And that always starts with generosity. How can you help other people? Putting the focus outside of yourself and on the people in your lives. Now, there's many ways that we can offer value to people. It could be knowledge, right? A lot of us here in this room have some very specific knowledge when it comes to style. Are you sharing that with your friends? Do the people in your life know that you are knowledgeable about that? And is it something that they can value in you? Another easy way to build value is to simply listen. In today's world, a lot of us are so tied to our phones and so tied to our Facebook feed that we don't realize that people want to be heard. And offering the capability of listening to someone is truly valuable in today's world. Once you start building that network, those relationships, you need to start sharing them to build true social capital. A lot of us, when we think about networking and connections, we like to hoard them to ourselves. We're very nervous that if we introduce people to someone else, they could do a business deal without us, we could be cut out. But in actuality, it's the sharing of your network, the sharing of resources that builds true social capital. That is how we've been able to build a company from scratch with no funding, by sharing our network. So, for example, if we meet someone who is in the fashion world, who's talking about style, telling them about StyleCon and introducing them to Aaron is a great way to share and build that connection, build that trust. Obviously, Aaron will get benefit out of having this person join, and the person that we introduced Aaron to will get benefit. So sharing is a very important part of building your personal value that you can offer to other people. Now, every event, opportunity, institution, moment, it's all driven by people, relationships. So it's very important that you guys start thinking about the relationships in your life and adding value to them. Those relationships are incredibly valuable to your success. Right? When it comes to getting a raise, getting a job, who do we look to? Right? We look to the people we know, the people that we trust. So you want to expand your reach and build trust in numerous people so you'll have more opportunities. Now, sharing is an ongoing exercise. A lot of times we get so caught up in transactional networking, where we might give a favor, give some time, help someone out, but then we have this calculator going on in the back of our head. Did that person help us back? Did I get my reward from being so generous? And that actually harms your social value, your social capital. It's important to look at generosity every single day. Can you share some knowledge on Facebook? It could be an article that was really impactful to you. Can you share some mistakes with people who are also struggling and trying to get through some processes that you yourself have overcome? Now, the third phase of building that social capital is about maintenance. As I said earlier, it's not just about service connections. You want to be investing in people over and over again, giving them time, giving them you. So that allows you to maintain a strong network. And those people can count on you when it matters, and you can count on them when it matters. Now, a mistake that a lot of people make is they just set it and forget it, right? They follow along on Facebook, maybe they like a little bit, but they're not reaching out. You're not reaching out to your network, checking in with them, giving them a phone call, meeting for lunch. It's in that maintenance that real social capital builds over time and it starts compounding. And all of a sudden, these people are now looking to share and reciprocate with you. Now, the last phase of building that social capital is expanding outside of just your network. And the easiest way to do that is to become an influencer online. We all have a personal brand. In today's day and age, we all have Facebook, we all have LinkedIn. Are you using those tools to expand your reach so that people see you as an expert, people know what you're about, they understand your personality? So, social capital is the value that we bring to the table with others. And if you put other people first, you're going to get a tremendous amount of value out of your relationships.
I would say, shoot for first milestone is like build 1,000 to 2,000 subscribers in some context, whether that's emails, blog readers, Facebook fans, and ideally, active, engaged subscribers. Because that's telling you that you're on the right path, that you're providing information that people find value for. And when you hit that milestone, then you don't have to go out and create the product, but you can start emailing them and ask, or taking polls, somehow finding what their big pain points are, and you can create a sales. Like, this is what I'm doing right now for the dance channel. So my dance channel, we just got to like 3,000 subscribers, which is not huge, but it's enough to where it's like, okay, I think I'm ready to try a product. And so I hired a copywriter. They've written a sales page based on the angle I think that addresses a big pain point in my audience. I haven't made the product yet, and I'm not going to make it until people pay for it. And it says, I'm going to run it like a Kickstarter promo. Hey, you're going to get access to this dance course on April 1st or April 30th because you're a supporter of mine, you can get it at 50% off for this special launch. So they know it's, you know, they know they're not going to get it right away. If nobody signs up, then I know, okay, I need to kind of go back and write a different sales page or try a different offer. But I haven't. The one mistake I made for products was making this, you know, spending months building this, you know, awesome course, and nobody bought it, and I was so mad. Like, I've done that like 3 times, so I don't do that anymore.
Now, when you talk about info products, explain to people who don't know what an info product is, what is it? Is it a PDF? Is it video? What is a info product?
Yeah, that's a good question. So, because I remember when I used to own a furniture company, and when I came to my first internet marketing conference, I was like, what are these products? I'm like, are they chairs? Like, I don't get it. So, if think of it, an info product is just you kind of coaching a person one-on-one and teaching them how to do whatever it is that they want to learn from you. Now, maybe that is through a PDF, maybe it's through a video, maybe it's through a Skype session, maybe it's through a printed newsletter or some combination. The media of how you deliver it doesn't really matter, like in the sense that it's more about what's gonna be easiest for your audience to use and consume. So you, again, like the previous guy was talking about, think about your user and what they want. But an info product is just you teaching something that you know how to do to somebody else. And I believe it's your responsibility to give them the 80-20, give them the short, simple stuff without overdoing it and getting them lost in it.
The way that I got started in info products, I do have some. I used to have an image consulting firm where once my fitness center exploded, I started helping guys from around the country. They'd come in, I'd advertise on Google AdWords. They would come in for the weekend, take them shopping, trim their nose hairs, and all that good stuff. Well, when I started posting YouTube videos, I realized, oh, and by the way, back then, I charged $1,500 for the day for somebody to work with me, right? Incredible money. I was like, I can't believe somebody's paying me for this. When I started posting videos online, I realized that there was an audience much larger. There were guys all over the world that could not afford $1,500, but they could afford $25, $19, $15. And so that moment where I started posting videos and realizing that there was an audience outside of just the guys that could come in and work with me, I started shifting my business. I started creating these virtual services, these virtual products. PDF. I didn't know how to create a PDF. I didn't know what it was. But you figure it out, and that's sort of how I transitioned from working with people one-on-one to selling pretty much exclusively products, digital downloads online.
Well, I mean, I got started selling a BMX DVD to BMXers trying to get faster on their bike. So, like, I've been making info products since I made that DVD, and the internet just kind of became cool. And I made that DVD like by begging my dad, who was a videographer at the time, to film me in a gym demonstrating exercises to show BMXers how to get faster. It unfortunately didn't make me rich, because now I'm doing the style thing. But it was a lesson in the first sale that came in, I realized, holy crap, like this is like real. Like people do spend money while you're sleeping, and you can actually make a living doing this. Unfortunately, that market wasn't big enough, which is another problem a lot of guys face. They go into something with too small of a niche. And I've done that numerous times. That's why most of all my products are geared towards guys looking to meet women, because I know how big the market is.
Yeah, so a lot of the stuff that we talk about on Effortless Gen is somewhat general. We go deep sometimes, but I think the value of creating a product is the fact that you can go really deep on a certain subject. So like, for example, the lean wardrobe stuff I was talking about earlier, I touch on it on the website, but if you really want to know how to build one from scratch or how to make it work for you specifically, you can buy my product and I would teach you that. So just the fact that you can go deeper and it kind of provides extra value, and it takes me time too to build that thing. So that's why I charge for it. So,
didn't you used to have the graduate wardrobe?
Yeah, so my first product was like a $25 ebook, and that kind of, that did really well. Yeah, thanks, man. So that actually let me quit my job because I sold a lot. That did really well, and so you just kind of continue like doing things like that. And I haven't really changed my formula. I don't know if I'm doing it the right way or not. I just continue to do what I've been doing, which is asking my readers what it is that they want. And I continue to create the stuff that they ask for. And I think as far as like when you get more advanced, then there are other ways to like go beyond your readership and your market to sell to bigger audiences that you don't already have. I think, and Ryan's really great at that stuff, and that's why I talk to him, because he's smarter than me. But if you're starting small, then definitely just survey and ask.
So we're going to cover who the millennial man is, what style works for the millennial man the best, a return to the classics, and then why this is beneficial. So millennials are any person that's born between 1977 and 2000. We make up roughly about 25% of the US population, but as a generation, we have the power to influence our culture greatly, which is why it's important to understand who the millennial is. First, we're smarter. We're on track to become the most well-educated generation on history, according to a study done by Pew Research. Our power to communicate through internet and social media as if we're here to help each other through advice, sharing content, sharing personal experience is what connects us, which is why word of mouth influence is so important. Word of mouth influence is said to influence a purchase 48% more than just a regular TV ad. It's also why influencers and bloggers are so effective. You're getting honest reviews from people you look up to and trust. We're also a conscious generation. We care about how products are made, the production practices that brands use, and if we're helping people along the way, which is why millennials are 50% more likely to support a brand if this brand backs a good cause. Brands that stand more than for just their bottom line are brands that we're loyal to. Millennial men also run a minimal lifestyle. We want products that actually function with our life. If a product facilitates our day-to-day, that product becomes part of our daily wear or our daily carry. If it doesn't, it gets subtracted out of our lives because less is better. When that less is actually better, that pursuit of quality over quantity is the true essence of minimalism, and it goes beyond just our daily lives and seeps into the clothing we wear. We as a consumer are much more aware today and not as blind as our Generation X counterparts. The age of disposableness and instant gratification is out the door. We're looking for sustainability and functionality. So given all of this, what style suits the millennial man the best? So really quickly, let's summarize three common things that all millennial men have in common, which is basically what I've been speaking about. We have the pursuit of quality. Today's millennial man understands the value of quality and why we search for handmade goods and not mass production. We also have the pursuit of a proper fit. Today's millennial man understands presentation and proportions and how this can positively affect personal image. And finally, we have the pursuit of a better dressed man. I think this is a common theme across all our generation, no matter what style, and it's what contributes to this exponential growth and interest in menswear. A recent research firm released some data that showed over the last 2 years, the menswear industry has increased in sales growth by 4.1%. Just to put that in perspective, if you compare that to the women's wear industry within that same time frame, it has only risen around 2.8%. By 2017, menswear is projected to climb around 8.3%. It's a staggering growth, and it just shows how much interest men are putting today into their personal image. Here is another graph where you see that men's growth is actually outpacing alcohol sales. It's even outpacing computer and tablet sales. So that's a crazy amount of interest. So what style suits us best? All right, so given all of these three requirements that today's millennial man is looking for in his style, we have about three style exemplars that our current society falls in. Now these are very broad in aspect, but they're as follows. We have fast fashion, we have casual menswear, and we have classic menswear. Let's start with fast fashion. Here's where you get the idea of the modern gentleman, who usually sports pretty tight European cuts. Most of the clothing is mass-produced and pretty affordable. However, there are two major problems with this style that don't really work with our generation. First of all, we have the bad fit. Most of this clothing is either very tight or short-cropped, which contribute to an unbalanced and an unproportionate man. So you can see here, this gentleman looks like he has very long legs and a short torso. However, more importantly, we have the ethical side. Most of these brands that produce fast fashion engage in unethical production practices. To give you an example of this, I actually just recently, this week actually, I created a video where I compared a low-price suit to a high-price suit. The low price suit was from a major fast fashion brand, and one of my arguments against it were the ethical practices they used to produce their products and to be able to sell it at that lower price point. I did a lot of research, and just to give you an example of some of the things I found, in one of their factories, 200 of their employees, children, women, and men, passed out from
harsh chemical fumes from overwork and from malnutrition. And another factory in Bangladesh had actually collapsed on itself and it killed and injured several employees. These two factors really clash with our generation, and it's why this style is not really good. Next, we have casual menswear. Now, when I say casual menswear, like I said, these are very broad in aspect. I did it this way to kind of shorten the presentation a little bit. So when I say this is anything from smart casual to streetwear. Now here you can actually find honest brands that produce good quality clothing. The only issue that I find with this brand is that it's not completely fulfilling for today's millennial man. Like I already mentioned, today's man is looking to elevate his style that much more, to dress that much better. I mean, just look at all of you guys here today. You guys are a great representation of what today's generation is looking for in his clothing. Finally, we have classic menswear. This, in my opinion, is the style that fulfills all three requirements that today's man is looking for. You have good quality, you have proper tailoring, and most importantly, you have a style that exudes maturity. So let's return to the classics. Like I said, that pursuit of honest quality, that pursuit of a properly tailored man, and that pursuit to dress better have driven us to this style exemplar. Why? Because we have a properly tailored garment with classic menswear. We want craftsmanship and perfection. Tailoring was sought after at this time, and masters of the trade were abundant. What resulted were suits that fit men like gloves. The idea of a bad fit was almost non-existent during this era, which is why we constantly as bloggers push for a fit that doesn't constrict or sag. The amazing thing is that you guys as a generation understand this and pursue it.
So one of the ways that we can elicit an emotion, there's two of them. You guys ever heard of Nietzsche, right? So Nietzsche tells us, the true man wants two things, danger and play. All right, now he goes on to talk about some ways that we actually pursue that. I'm going to kind of riff on this a little bit for myself, but what I'm going to talk about is how we can elicit emotion through appealing to an aesthetic that is either one that's indicative of danger or one that's indicative of play. And if you take that kind of philosophical approach to your appearance, then it's a way that can consistently tell the story that you want it to, while at the same time eliciting the emotion from your audience that you want it to as well. Okay, this is one of the biggest things for me that was this kind of aha moment. I get asked a lot why I care so much, why I dress the way that I do, why I write about this stuff. I also get asked a lot about, oddly enough, I get asked if I can help women dress better. And my legitimate answer for that is that I can't. Because I believe that men and women have a fundamental difference in our reasons and our approaches to dressing well. For the vast majority of history, across the vast majority of cultures, the primary purpose of women dressing well has been to increase visual appeal. Whereas for men, the vast majority of history, across the vast majority of culture, the primary purpose for wanting to dress better is to increase visual power. And as soon as you understand that little difference, then it becomes very easy to see why the things that we do end up looking so different. Why you can have a woman in a gorgeous dress and a man in a strong suit. They create very different aesthetics, but they also elicit very different emotions. In fact, I'm going to show you what happens when you get the counter to that. What's your immediate response to something like this? Don't think about what's politically correct. Don't think about anything else like that. What's your immediate response to having a man put on makeup that is done in a way that's more feminine and it increases the visual appeal of him? It's kind of negative, right? And I mean, take that for what it is. I don't care if you think it's bad or it's not. I mean, it is what it is. That's your initial visceral responses. That's the wrong approach. Now, that doesn't to say that men can't work towards visual appeal, but the vast majority of masculine communication in aesthetics is a focus on power. It's a focus on the danger. Now, the more you move towards that other side of the barometer, the more you move towards that play, you can do that. But if you cross the Rubicon into the world of feminine or effeminate territory, that's where you're starting to get into a little bit of trouble. So that's the first way to balance the difference between danger and play. That's why the majority of men will typically, when they start to dress better, start focusing on a dangerous appearance. It's the badass, it's the vigilante, it's the biker or the rock star. It's all these ideas of, you know, I want to look tough and I want to look good and I want to look like a man, right? It's because, for the most part, that's where we come from, that's our history, and because it's easy. It's not to say that it's right or wrong, it's bad or good. So, okay, guy putting on makeup. Whoops, guy putting on makeup, right? Now this is a newscaster who's putting makeup on. And all of a sudden it's a very different context because it's not a way to increase visual appeal, right? We just know he's putting it on because he's gonna go on for a broadcast. It's not a way to make his eyes look bigger, which is indicative of more innocence. It's basically to just make sure that any blemishes or anything are covered up so that you're not distracted by these little flaws that exist in his skin and you're just able to pay attention to his message. So makeup in this context is a way to increase power. And what about in this context? These guys are covered head to toe in makeup, right? Is that increasing visual appeal or is it increasing visual power? Power, right? How? I mean, it's the same thing, it's makeup, right? It's body paint, but how is that communicating power? I wouldn't want to go up against that. That's even more terrifying than if they weren't wearing anything at all. If they weren't covered in that, it would make them less intimidating than what they are. And so understanding the context of what it is that you're trying to accomplish means that you can take the same approach and be able to do it in a way that it accomplishes the goals that you want it to. Okay, so danger, visual power, play, visual appeal, all right? Next way to look at this, let's keep going with this. George Washington in here, right? Can you imagine if you were wearing something like this today? Right? Like, you get a few chuckles and it's kind of funny, but I mean, I know McGinn's all about like skinny pants, but I still wouldn't be caught in something that skinny with your boots tucked in and all that. So we see this as what? More play, right? But then what happens when you compare it to this real dandy? All of a sudden, Washington, that's power, right? Look at the epaulets up on his shoulder. Look at that tall collar and way that makes him more physically imposing. Look at the discipline that's conveyed in that kind of outfit. Whereas this guy on the right, at one point in time, sure, that was considered to be masculine. And, you know, maybe if you guys want to come talk to me after, we can talk about the difference between, you know, abundant societies and how that's reflected in an appeal aesthetic versus a power aesthetic, but I could do that for an hour. But all of a sudden you take this look and you compare it in a subjective context to something that is much more indicative of danger as opposed to being play. It's kind of interesting, right?
So I'm gonna teach you two very, very simple ways to come up with a really powerful, really unique niche for your business, and then very briefly how to name it. And I'm gonna try to leave plenty of time for questions and maybe even some workshopping. If any of you guys are at that stage where you wanna start something, we can talk a little bit about your idea and see if we can hone it down. Cool? Okay, this is important because the competition is very stiff right now. This isn't 2008, you know, it's not 2009. It's 2016 and there are a lot of blogs and there's a lot of YouTube channels. On WordPress alone, there's 76 million blogs. So that's one blogging platform. You know, on the whole internet, there's probably 300 million plus blogs. You know, who knows how many Instagram accounts and Twitter accounts and YouTube channels. Every day, 50,000 new blogs are created. You know, that's a hard number to even imagine. 3 million new blog posts are published. So since I started talking, over 200 blogs have been created. So for one person, every person in this room, like, created a new site since I've been on this stage. You know, I don't say this to discourage you, though. You know, I want you to start something. You know, starting The Modest Man, my site has been the best decision I ever made. You know, it can lead to the freedom that you want. You know, whether it's financial freedom or time freedom or location independence, it can do that. But I don't recommend right now in 2016 starting another Real Men Real Style, you know, or going up against GQ. I think you have to specialize. And especially at the beginning, you have to do something that really sets you apart from the competition. And after you do that, after you make a name for yourself and you grow an audience, even a small audience, you can branch out. You know, and you can talk about whatever you want. But you gotta do something at the beginning to get noticed. So that's what I did. I picked something about myself, you know, the most fundamental thing. I'm a short guy, right? And I specialize in that because I realize that it's really hard to dress well as a guy that's 5'6 in boots, 130 pounds soaking wet. You know, clothes don't fit me. And I thought, well, if I have this problem, maybe the other 20 million adult American men who are under 5'9 also have this problem. And so I built a website that solves that problem. And, you know, people always say to me, usually you know, guys who aren't really in like the online blogging space, they say, you know, man, you should pivot a little bit and like open up your range because like a lot of your content applies to every guy, not just shorter guys. So like, why not get everybody? And I say, I don't want everybody. You know, I want the modest men. Because right now I'm only reaching 100,000 of them every month. I want a million, you know, 10 million. And that's enough. Like, you don't need every single person to visit your website to build a lucrative business. You can do it with 100 true fans, 1,000 true fans, you know, 10,000 true fans. So I would encourage you to specialize right at the beginning, and the methods I'm going to teach you will help you do that, and they're really, really simple. So the first method is called the two qualifier rule, okay? And this is the idea that you take whatever topic you're passionate about, fitness, style, cooking, whatever, and you add two unique qualifiers to turn it into a special niche that you can be the authority in. So we'll go through a couple examples of this. Say you're passionate about cooking. I don't think it's a good idea to compete with food.com, you know, or All Recipes, or Food Network, or Martha Stewart, or the tens of thousands of other cooking blogs that are out there. So let's add some qualifiers. Cooking for men. We're already getting somewhere. We've already eliminated half the population, which is a good thing. Okay, but still, there's a lot of guys that want to cook. Cooking for men with children. And now we have something like dadskitchen.com. And if that's available, go buy it right now, by the way. And the thing is, dadskitchen.com is cool because dad is unique, you know? Dad has 2 hours of work to do after dinner, and he got home late, and it's his night to cook, and his daughter doesn't like vegetables, and his son is in a peanut butter sandwich phase, you know, and he's got 20 minutes, and he's got to whip something up, and he wants to be healthy, and he can't cook, you know. So he Googles, and he finds food.com and Martha Stewart, and then he sees dadskitchen.com. You better believe he's clicking on dadskitchen.com. And when he finds it, if he likes your content, you've got yourself a fan for life, guaranteed, 100%. And if you have a cookbook, he's buying your cookbook, you know. And it's not that mom doesn't like dadskitchen.com. In fact, I think mom will probably leave it open on dad's computer so he starts pulling his weight around here. But dad's gonna love dadskitchen.com. And it's better to have one loyal fan than 1,000 casual readers.
So here's the deal. I hear a lot of podcasts. I've been a guest on a lot of podcasts. How do you find people to actually go on your podcast? What is your qualifier? What are you looking for? What type of guys are you going out there and interviewing? Tanner?
So I'm a little bit different because for me, interviewing isn't the main format of my podcast, but one of the things that I've started experimenting with is bringing on a couple of different guys at once and trying to do it as a panel discussion. In fact, I had Aaron on, Aaron and Brock on as one. And for me, what I would like to do with it is have it feel more like it's a conversation and you're kind of a fly on the wall as opposed to it just being a direct interview with a lot of questions, especially because so many guys have such good information that's how I try to find the guys is they have good information, they know what they're talking about, and they have a message that they want to share.
AJ?
Well, podcasting has changed quite a bit thanks to Serial. Now, most of our guests actually reach out to us. So in the beginning, you know, 8 years ago, we were begging people to come on the show, trying to tell them how important podcasting was and how the reach on podcasting could really connect with people.
Why is the reach so great?
Because a lot of people commute to work, and watching a video while you're driving is pretty much next to impossible, if not illegal. So, you know, talk radio exists for that matter, and unfortunately for millennials, there's not a lot of talk radio hosts that speak to us. So it allows us to have a voice. Everyone at this point has a smartphone, so it's very accessible.
Ted, how do you find guests?
I look for people who I connect with and look for that the connection with their message, with their knowledge, and also curiosity. So I'm never strategic in the way like, oh, I think that guest will really bring in a lot of people. It's always got to come from the heart. And people can tell the difference when you're more strategic versus when you have people you're sincerely interested in.
Eric?
So for us, we're maybe closer to Tanner. We don't have ongoing interviews. We're a co-host format, so it's me and my co-host Clayton who do it on a weekly basis, which makes it really easy to produce content. But like we have the advantage of built a community that we can really leverage, and finding any kind of talent isn't tough, but the challenge is I want them to come into Austin and do the interview in person rather than like a Skype interview.
How about you, Ryan?
Yeah, for me, you know, I'm similar to AJ in that I have a lot of people contact me at this point, and it's amazing how many leadership experts there are. I get emails every single day from a leadership expert that wants to come on the show. So I'm actually looking for very unique stories, unique perspectives, unique stories that they have and examples of how they've lived their life so that we can create something unique and not similar to everything else that's going on. So I'm looking for a unique story.
I have a new style podcast that was just put out on Wednesday, and I'm not going to talk about that one. What I'm going to talk about is the one I run over at High Speed Low Drag. And the reason that the way we get guests is they have to actually have a unique qualifier, and they have to be a military veteran. So when you run a podcast, sometimes you can have something like that, and then it really niches down, but it also allows you to bring on people that you probably normally couldn't. So we're able to bring on a lot of veterans who people don't know they're veterans, and they're actually pretty famous. Barbara Corcoran, I know John Lee Dumas was able to get on simply because of, you know, she's on Shark Tank, simply because she makes time for veterans.
And I've mentioned it multiple times, but I got fired from my company. I didn't start my business because I really had this big ambition. I was like in a corner. I gotten fired, it was 2007, and I had to make money. And I realized no one's gonna hire me because even though I've got this really impressive background, MBA, Marine Corps, what business owners or the people that were hiring, they wanted to see experience, and I didn't have much. And they're also going to wonder, why did you get fired 3 months into working for a company? And I just realized, okay, now it's going to be, I thought it was easier to go the entrepreneurial path, and I was very wrong, but I'm very happy that I made that choice. After I got fired, I then proceeded to fail with my first business. Everyone sees like a tailored suit. We were one of the first companies to bring in the online. It was me, Indochino, and a suit that fits. I remember looking out there and being, wow, this is awesome. Like I'm gonna be a $1 million company within a year. And 5 years later, I'm getting close to that $1 million company, but I'm losing money. And I'm like, you know, you can't scale losses. And it took me a while to figure that out. And then I started focusing on things that worked. People started seeing my wins on YouTube. I started being able to turn that into actually real money. This just last year, I got the numbers back from my accountant, and we had our most profitable year ever. I now have almost a dozen people that are working for me across the world, and I'm really, really proud of what I've been able to build up. But the journey is not, it's not straight up. It's not like this linear growth hockey chart, which we oftentimes see like from Facebook and all these other ones. Sometimes it's that way, but most of the time we go through a lot of the struggles. So guys, I'd love to hear from you, like a little bit about your journey and some of the struggles that you've gone through on your path through entrepreneurship. Maybe we'll start off with Adam of Tanner.
I think it's an interesting point to talk about the failures that people have had, because even for me as an entrepreneur, seeing people and finding role models, it seemed like everyone was successful and they never had any failures. So I think it's a really important point to mention that I think all of us, at least I can speak for myself, have had other companies in the past that didn't work. And I think that is part of the story. So my background is in dermatology and plastic surgery, skincare. I had my own skincare company. We were selling well in Sephora. And you know, I think there's so many pieces to small business, and you're responsible for running all aspects of it, that it can be very overwhelming. And that particular company, you know, we were in 1,000 stores right off the bat, and it almost went too fast, too soon, and we were unable to keep up with it. So that business actually went under. So I think that it's important to know that along the way, I think there's more failures than successes. But it's a matter of what you learn from those situations. So I would say with Tanny and the company that I have now, I have tried my hardest to take all of the lessons learned from every failure that I've had and the successes as well, to try to figure out how to make this particular business more successful based on the problems that I had in the past. And I think that's just part of the journey for an entrepreneur to fall and pick yourself up again and do your best to learn from the past and keep pushing forward till you can find a way to succeed.
All right, Eric.
Yeah, I mean, failure is an ongoing thing with entrepreneurship. A lot of times, I've got a whole wake of failed startups behind me. And not only that, you should expect failure within your active business because failure is a crucial part of growing your company and trying new things. And the key is how to fail without jeopardizing the whole business. So you take, we continuously have failed projects and ideas and products, but it's just a way to grow. And then with that, you have successes. And it's those successes that you find that you build off of and make better and execute on and grow.
Yeah, I also started my first company back in 2001. And I live in Switzerland, so it was kind of a different environment. Switzerland is kind of a tough place. They look at entrepreneurship a little bit differently. People are a little bit more scared to kind of crash and burn. So I started my first company in 2001, and it failed. And I think a lot of it had to do with the fact that I spent so much time trying to write the perfect business plan and to get every detail. I had an implementation plan, and I just didn't, take action quick enough. So when I started TextWeapon about 3 years ago, I decided to try and learn from that. So I did make an implementation plan, and I came up with a business plan. But at the same time, I started putting articles out. I started up a Twitter account. I think that, as these people have said, you can't be scared of failure, but at the same time, you have to learn from it, and it's just too costly, to keep making the same mistakes. No, you can't make it again, so.
All right, Mike?
Yeah, I think a couple of things. Fail quickly is really important, and if you can embrace those failures and make changes really quickly, you can adapt as a business and grow. First 3 years of my business, I failed pretty miserably because I really didn't know anything about apparel when I started. And there's a lot of nuances in the production process that I really was not aware of. And learned my lesson the hard way, not the smart way. I didn't have like a mentor, which I think is a great recommendation for people. If you can find a mentor, do it. But you can't let the failures get you down. You just have to look at the failures and you have to adapt and change and see where you made the problem, where you made the mistakes, and adapt as quick as you can and fix those.
You can show me pictures of my vacation in Greece. I went there with my wife a few years ago. It was amazing. You could show me those pictures and I will feel a certain detached fondness that one would feel from a picture. But if you let me smell the scent of fig leaves or cooking gyro meat, I'll instantly be in Greece in my heart and in my emotions. And there's reasons for that. And there's scientific reasons for that because our brain is wired to smell. And I'm not a scientist, I'm not a biologist, I'm not a doctor, I'm not a specialist in any of these fields, so my knowledge of this is very pedestrian, obviously. But here's kind of a rundown of how scent works. You have a smell, scent molecules, they go up to your nose, they hit the olfactive nerve, and that impulse is sent through your brain to a part of your brain called the amygdala, which is a really ancient part of our brains. Now that part of our brain is connected with emotions. And so scent literally touches our emotions. And that's why these memories, whenever we smell something, it takes us out of where we are and puts us back into this place where we feel things again. And what does this mean for you? What is this, all this stuff, how can I use this to your advantage? Well, when you wear a scent, you're sending a message. And that message can differ depending on what you want to send. And one of the things you can send is an increase in confidence. Now, confidence can be for you. Whenever you smell good, you feel good. I can guarantee if any of you forgot your deodorant today, and you didn't shower last night or something, you'd be extremely self-conscious. Even if you were dressed in, to the nines, you'd be extremely self-conscious.
because our scent can either add or take away from our confidence. And right now, you know, I feel like I'm the best smelling guy in the room. And whether that's objectively true or not, I feel like that. And so that's an increase in confidence for me. And because that is increasing confidence for me, I think that projects on other people as well. And so that's the first thing you can do. A fragrance is an instant increase in your style and fashionability. You don't have to tailor it. All you have to do is get it. You spray it on, and that's it. It's such an easy add-on to your fashion. The next thing that it can do is it can give you an edge for the ladies. Okay, I know a lot of you guys are interested in ladies, and there's no smoking gun. Every lady is different, obviously, but women are obviously different than men. They use more of their amygdalas than men do. Scent is extremely important with women than it is for men, and they automatically understand the importance of it. Perfume is a regular addition to their grooming routine already, and we understand that. And when you wear a fragrance and you're talking to a woman, the message that you're saying is, I care about the details that you care about. And that's an important message that we want to send. I think that's the right message that we want to send, that we care about something that the lady that we're interested in also cares about. Another thing that we can be mindful of is etiquette. And I don't just mean just the number of sprays that we're using, although that is important. But what I mean is, you know, there are certain scents that are certain that are better for certain occasions and better for certain seasons. Some guys don't know this. And it's just, think of it like what you would wear in summer, what you would wear in winter. You know, you wouldn't go to the beach and wear a three-piece suit and sit in the sand. I think that would be really awkward. You wouldn't go to a black tie event and wear a swimsuit. That would also be awkward. And if you did those things, people would probably either think that you are an idiot or that you might be really disrespectful in some cases. And so we need to be mindful of how we do that. And I'm not gonna get into the details of how that works. I have, you know, videos that talk about that. But our etiquette really plays an important part of this. There are paragons that we look up to in men's fashion and style. When I think of timeless men in style, I think of James Dean. I think of James Bond. I think of Cary Grant. I think of Frank Sinatra. We look up to these men, and all we see are their pictures, but what we don't realize is these same men were known for wearing fragrances. And it's one thing to see a picture and feel a certain detached fondness that you would get from seeing that picture. It's another thing to be in that person's presence and feel their persona from their scent. I guarantee you, if I were in Frank Sinatra's presence, smelling the fragrance that he had, it would be a completely different experience than seeing a picture of him. And that's how we want to do whenever we wear a fragrance.
It took me 6 years to get 100,000 subscribers, and then 18 months to get another million. It is a grind. I mean, when Antonio and I started, it's changed. YouTube has changed a lot in the way that it promotes people, in the way that it facilitates your growth. It wasn't immediate. It absolutely wasn't immediate. But what has come as a result of some of the growth has been other business opportunities. And so now, one of the beautiful things about where I'm at is because I've built this audience based on trust and love, you know, I can do these and take these little risks that really are less risky because I've got this built-in audience. And so my appetite, and here's the other thing I'll just say about failure before I wrap this up and let you guys get home to your families, is failure doesn't scare me. Once you get that out of the way, right? Failure, whatever, it happens. It sucks, you'll get over it, you gotta move forward. What scares the shit out of me is having an idea or having something that I think or I know or I wanna do and not doing it. I don't wanna regret anything. And so for you guys out there, you know, how long have you been thinking about starting this or doing this? It would be really cool. What happens when somebody else does it? How pissed are you gonna be when you see somebody else that you know you could have done it better, or it was your idea or whatever it is? You know, don't live with the regrets. If you've got a passion, if you've got something that you want to do, get out there and do it. If you fail, who cares? You'll be all right, I promise. Move forward. Thanks, guys.